As you number two, obviously we were on number one last week, and we're on number two this week, the attitude of repentance. You'll notice that all these attitudes are taken out of Matthew, the Beatitudes, Matthew chapter 5, 6, and 7, which is also described as the Sermon on the Mount, what also can be described as, generally speaking, could be described as the living principles. A lot of what we call conditional promises. In the Sermon on the Mount. In other words, a conditional promise would be, God telling Rick, God telling you, God telling us that if you'll do this, I'll do that. And if you'll apply this truth to your life, here's the way that I will respond. And here's how you'll benefit from that. And many of these attitudes that we just read, or the scriptures that we read, that I suppose represent the attitudes, are like that. And this also being one of them. The Bible says in Matthew chapter 5 and verse 4, as we just read a couple of minutes ago, blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Now, if you just skim over that, it sounds extremely, it sounds very spiritual, doesn't it? It sounds like something that we don't usually say, but if you will not agree, and I'm not trying to convince you into the fact that the description that I'm fixing to give it, when I say blessed are those who mourn, when we find out the definition of a few words in that verse, one being the word blessed. When we say blessed, it refers to as us being happy. And I know happiness is an emotion, and in fact, God gives you emotions. It's just like sadness is an emotion, anger is an emotion, and we're not certainly here to be philosophical or give you any psycho Bible, but Jesus really said, he said, happy are you, but here's the strange part. He said, happy are you when you mourn.
That's right.
That's strange. I mean, I don't care any way you look at it, because the word mourn refers to grieve inwardly or grieve outwardly. Now, I don't really get, when you look at it, in my mind's eye, or just from a secular point of view, without the word of God spiritually speaking, because he's talking about something there when he says it, which is the most important thing that we can make comment to, is he said, blessed are those, happy are you when you grieve. And so if I'm grieving and I'm happy, I'm not thinking that he's saying that when you're grieving, you're supposed to be happy. I think the byproduct or the manifestation of our grief, if it's correct, and it is focused toward God, and by the way, given to God, then the product of that, or the manifestation of that, or his response to that, is you'll be comforted. You can be eventually happy after your grief. It's not the will of God for us to stay mourning in order to be happy. To stay grieving, in other words, that would be ridiculous. We run around crying all day. Somebody says, what's wrong? No, man, I'm just happy. it ain't got nothing to do with that. That would be ridiculous. Somebody would think, you need more help than you might need. Well, that's not the case. I've mourned before. I've grieved before. And I would venture to say that everybody in the room has, too. I've done it, and by the way, I've done it with the wrong motives. I've done it deceptively. If you needed a tear out of me, I could probably drop one within about the first 5 minutes of the conversation if I needed to get something from somebody, or needed to get let back in the house, or give me back my keys, or lend me $5, or, nobody understands me, and stuff like that. We can kind of let it pour, and we can pour on the fake mourner, so to speak, but that's not what Jesus is talking about. Blessed are those who grieve and mourn, not just over their condition, but their sin.
Yeah.
Well, that's different. That's different. And I'm going to tell you, fellas, that is not necessarily a thing that we get to overnight with regard to our walk with the Lord, because I don't think most of us, and I include myself, especially initially in the first part of my Christian life, really had any sense of the gravity of the effects of my sin, not just on my life, but on my relationship and my fellowship with God. Mm-hmm. And so when we understand that we can take our sin to God, not just because we're grieving, but the fact that we're grieving because of what our sin does and is doing to us, and give it to God, and we give it to God, and what does he do? He forgives us. I'm going to tell you what, happiness is, if you want to say that, blessing is right around the corner. It is. I hope I could say, and I hope I can speak for some of the room, and it doesn't leave, don't check out on me if I can, But I think some of you are more blessed now than you've been perhaps in the past.
Yeah.
Amen.
Based on your response to what God offers, and what he offers is our opportunity for what we're talking about tonight is repentance. God offers that. The Bible says that goodness of God leadeth us to repentance. In other words, an awareness, not just of the reality of God, but the activity of God should lead me to know that God is a forgiving God. But I'm going to tell you what, outside of the truth of his word, I won't know how to respond to what God offers until I am informed, so to speak, as to what I'm supposed to do. What is my response to that? I could throw out the word repentance, and not because everybody in the room doesn't know what they're talking about or has never learned it, but I'm sure a handful, and I would have been one of them, that did, you know, if somebody said to me 30 years ago, this November, like I say, November 29, 1984, somebody would have said to me that night, and by the way, I had written in a book, I was by myself when I got saved, but if somebody would have put me to the test and said, well, Rick, if you want God's forgiveness in your life, what you need to do, bro, is repent. Bye. I'd have been left to myself, man. I would have had any idea what you're talking about. In fact, I didn't know what the word saved meant. I didn't know what born again meant. I didn't know what anything, any of those Bible phrases, by the way, they're Bible phrases. They're not Baptist, Pentecostal, you know, Episcopalian, Wesleyan, or anything. They're Bible phrases.
Is there repentance? Is it the same thing as guilty?
It will be, and you're going to hear a perfect explanation of that, hopefully, near perfect explanation of that. Just hang on, man. You're getting it. And so when we look at it, let me read you a couple paragraphs, and in a couple minutes we're going to be in 2 Chronicles chapter number 6, and we're going to get a little bit more in depth with it, not to a deeper level, but to a more practical level. Repentance is the regret and reluctance that arises in a person when he's done something that he ought not to have done. In other words, that's where it's initiated. When Judas saw Christ, that Christ was condemned, it said of him that he repented of what he had done. Now, it's interesting that the Bible uses that word, and it's not the same word for what we're talking about. Let me explain. He was extremely afflicted in his mind about what he wished he had not done. But this repentance arises from a fear of punishment condemned against sin, and is not accompanied with the admission of sin. The same goes when we experience the fallout of our rebellion. We reflect upon our activities with sorrow, but we still have a great love for the sin as we did prior to the rebellion. And I think that most of us can relate to that. In other words, I'm sorry for what I did. I'm not necessarily sorry that I did it. I'm sorry that it happened, but I'm not grieved over the fact that I committed this, I participated in this rebellion. I'm sorry for what it caused because I'm experiencing the fallout of my own rebellion. And so that's not Bible repentance. Listen, we may be sorry for what we did, and more so because of what we did, but only because we have caused our punishment and we are not yet grieved that we have offended God. There's a difference there. I don't know about you, but prior to coming to Christ, and it makes me no better than any man that has not come to Christ, if you're here this evening and if you've not made that decision, but prior to coming to Christ, God was not for me personally, and that's my own just personal experience, God was not for me personally in the equation when it came to my grieving over what I had done. Until I needed somebody to get me out of what I had done. And then he's brought into the equation. God, get me out of this. God, listen, I wasn't thinking about God 5 minutes before the bottom fell out. And all of a sudden, what's going on? I'm thinking about God. Why? Because he's the last string I can think of pulling. Everybody else lost my number, or I lost theirs, or vice versa. They made sure they weren't going to answer, and we can go on and on and on with that. But we think, listen, God instilled in us the reality of his mercy, and then we called on him. Isn't that interesting? That's what Jesus said. It's the activity of God when all this is going on. In John chapter 6 and verse 44, remember when he said, no man cometh unto me unless the Father draw him? In other words, could it be, and I say yes, this is not a question that can't be answered, could it be that the activity of God in our rebellion, God used a means and a way and orchestrated the circumstances so we could come to him, think about him, and call upon him? But most of us, and again, I ain't reading your mail, most of us called on him, but it really didn't have anything to do with him. It had everything to do with us.
Yeah, sure.
That's where it's got to change.
Yeah.
Listen, biblical repentance, the saving grace wrought in the soul by the Spirit of God, whereby a sinner is made aware of his sin, is grieved and humbled before God on account of it, not so much for the punishment to which the sin has made him accountable, as that thereby God is dishonored and offended and his word is violated. This grief arises from a love for God and is accompanied with hatred of the sin. It's then that God by his Spirit gives us a desire for holiness and a fixed resolution to forsake the sin. That's, fellas, I got that wrong for a long, long time. God forgive me, but I am not interested in letting go of it. That's where we miss it, fellas. That's where we miss it. And I'm not saying it's just we walk away from sin like we're never, ever going to want it again. No, you're still allured, attracted, and enticed by it, or the Bible wouldn't talk about it from cover to cover. You're still going to be tempted by it. You know, blessed is the man when he is tempted. There's no temptation to take any man, but such is common to man, but God is faithful. We're not allowed to be tempted above that which you're able. With the temptation, all we make of escape, we have escape that you're able to bear. Why would Paul write about that? Because temptation is a reality. But when I ask God to forgive me of the sin, when I'm asking him to forgive me, what I'm saying, scripturally speaking, when we line up, you know, our motives and our words with the word of God, I'm saying, God, I'm sorry for what I did. I'm sorry that I sinned against you, and I need help not to do it again. Yeah. To forsake it. To forsake it means to walk away from it, to turn from it. And when we do that, listen, we can't do that necessarily on our own. We need the help of God to do that.
Amen.
And fellas, if you won't try, most of us have tried this on our own. You know? And then, you know, and hopefully that's the reason we cry out to God. God said that. God invites us to cry out to him. Call me in the day of trouble and I'll deliver you. And you will glorify me. God invites us to do that. But listen, all of this is followed by the expectation. In other words, what do I expect, according to the word of God, what do I expect God to do when I ask him to forgive me? Not because I deserve it, by the way. And not because I'm telling him to forgive me. I'm asking him to forgive me. What can I expect according to the word of God? I can expect God to forgive me. I can expect that. But we shouldn't use that flippantly, like, here comes Friday, and I'm just going to tear it up till Monday, and God's going to forgive me. No, God didn't play like that. And if you were a parent, you wouldn't play like that either.
No.
And God is the believer's father. He don't roll like that. If I can affectionately use that, I'm not dumbing down the word of God, but he doesn't do that. No, God expects me to work with him as he works in and through me. Get this stuff out of my life. So I'm just not this habitual running to God for his forgiveness. Now we all need it daily. We all need it daily. Romans chapter 6 and verse 14, fellas, listen and get this deep down in your heart. Write it down, memorize it. Sin shall no longer have dominion over you. Dominion. That's what dope did. Or whatever your deal was. Dominion. Dominance. It will not dominate you anymore. Who did Paul write that to? He wrote that to the church in Rome. He wrote that to the believer. Now, if I'm not a believer, and I'm not saying that we're trying to put everybody in one basket and make sure that, you know, it this doesn't pertain to you. You can apply the Bible principles to your life. You can, and your life will be a little bit different. But I can tell you this, and I'm just saying this on the authority of the Word of God, your heart won't. Your heart won't. You can abide by good rules and standards and stuff like that and improve your life. But what the Bible does to a relationship with Jesus Christ, listen, because of repentance and that time, that experience with God, when you ask God to forgive you, you invited Christ to come into your life, you were born again, as the Bible says in John chapter 3, you were saved. That gives you an opportunity, listen, to change from the inside. Not just change on the outside. Not just change your habits and whatever else, you know, it's described as, or hang-ups or whatever it might be. See, I got addicted to, and maybe you did too. Really, from a biblical perspective, I got addicted to my sin. Because if Paul says sin shall no longer have dominion over you, he's implying that it did. And I'm not saying that everybody took it to the level that maybe some of us did, and I'm ashamed to have to admit that, but it was what it was. It's not what it is. It was what it was. But I know this, I got addicted to it. And I'm not proud to say this, and don't check out on me after I say it, but I didn't mind it either. I didn't mind it. I mean, I wouldn't go, oh, no, man, not another weekend. Not some more dope. Not some more alcohol. Oh, man. I didn't think like that. Man, I was kind of, maybe you can relate to that, I was kind of event-driven, you know? The next thing.
Yeah.
The next thing. The next person,
or the next place, or the next substance, or the next, you know, whatever. Fill in your own blank. And there was this anticipation of something that was going to be better than just God. Because that's really what we're doing. That's really what we're doing. What we're saying to God is, God, you're not enough. You're not enough. I need another feeling aside from the feelings that you offer me. And see, listen, God's not all about feelings. Feelings are a part of the Christian life. But if you're dictated and governed by your feelings, you will be like I was. You will be one messed up dude. Because it's not about feelings. Because guess what? We don't always feel good. Any Christian in here that's been straight and sober for a little while feel good every day? No. I speak for you. No. Okay? And if you're up here on a mountain every single day, take me with you. You know what I'm saying? I mean, life throws you some curveballs every once in a while, and sometimes life is not all fun. But I'm going to tell you what, that doesn't mean that I alter my feeling in order to adjust it to my day. No, man. My joy is in the Lord.
Amen.
And that's a constant. That has nothing to do primarily with my happiness. And repentance, listen, is what gets us there, fellas. And listen, what keeps us there. Now listen, First Corinthians, let me read a couple of verses to you. We're going to get into 2 Chronicles chapter 6. 2 Corinthians chapter 7 and verse 10, the Bible says, "For godly sorrow worketh repentance to salvation." Now that's obviously talking about our relationship with God initially. See, in other words, I can't call myself a Christian until I have done what the Bible says I needed to do in order to become a Christian. And that's why I'm sure that the Bible, that the Holy Spirit inspired the writer of John when Jesus said you must be born again to record that. In other words, it's a new birth. And Paul comes along and parallels that verse, so to speak, in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17, where he says, "Any man being in Christ is a new creature." And that word means what? Creation. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. You're brand new. No, you're the same age physically and biologically and everything like that. But according to God, you're brand new. What started that? Godly sorrow, the awareness of our sin. And listen, when you got saved, if you've been saved, most of us weren't grieved because of our sin. Most of us were just somebody by the grace of God, and it was God Himself orchestrated the circumstances in your life and my life so we could be made aware of the truth of God's Word so we could respond to it. And our response was, I'm going to get a chance, and I'm just generally speaking, I'm going to get a chance to ask God to forgive me.
Amen.
And God's going to do it. And I'm going to receive Jesus Christ. But as many as received Him, to them gave you the power to become sons of God or children of God. And so we get an opportunity to respond to what God's already done. And that Bible term for our response is repentance. We turn from our sin and we turn to God. And fellas, listen. Make sure you know this. That's got nothing to do with denominational lines. It's got nothing to do with that. Got everything to do with what I need the most is forgiveness.
Amen.
And then I'm a part of the body of Christ.
Oh, yeah.
And then what I need after that is God's people and God's Word, not in that order. The Holy Spirit of God indwells me. Now I'm equipped to start growing in the Lord.
Amen.
It don't matter what you want to call yourself. It doesn't matter about that. No disrespect to any other, whether denominations or anything like that. When I got saved, November 29th, 1984, I wasn't a Baptist. I was a Christian.
Amen.
And then soon after that, I joined a Baptist church. And I was still a Christian.
Do that.
I didn't cease to become a Christian and start to become a Baptist. I'm Baptist because I'm a member of a Southern Baptist church, and I'm not ashamed of that. But it's all about the Bible. There's not going to be any signs in heaven. If there is one, redeemed.
Amen.
Saved. Maybe a smaller word so we all get it. You know what I mean? Saved. And God knows. God knows who are His. He knows it now. It won't be then. It is now. Repent. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. John the Baptist said that in Acts chapter 3, verse 19. After Jesus had already died and was resurrected and ascended into heaven. Repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out. There's the application right there. Many people initially, listen, through ignorance, have an incorrect perception of the mercy of God. There are some who think that since God is a God of love, he will overlook anything and everything and allow us to live any way that we wish to live without ever reaping the consequences for ungodly living. One might say, just live the way that you want to, and when things close in on you because of your rebellion, just tell God you're sorry, and then tell him what you need. Guilty. And you wonder how I wrote it, you know, because, I mean, you know, this is a screenplay, okay? Part of that, listen, part of that is correct, and part of that is incorrect. Yes, we are responsible for telling God we're sorry for our sin, but we do so because of what we need the most, forgiveness. That's what we need. And by the way, if you hadn't received God's forgiveness, you don't have a greater need in your life tonight. And I say that respectfully. You don't. In spite of whatever needs you might have, you have the need for forgiveness. And listen, now stay with me. Forgiveness. Repentance is not about getting what we want. It's about getting what we need. I, like many others, have been guilty of the same thing. I tell God I'm sorry, and then give him my list. You know what I mean? I may as well start there. I may as well start with sorry, right? You know what that is? That's human behavior. That's exactly what that is. If I've done you wrong, and I need something out of you, and I'm anywhere close to being a manipulator, where do you think I'm going to start?
I'm sorry, man.
Come on, man. We're brothers, right? Come on, man. And once I got you, and hopefully I wouldn't do that, But money, some of us have done that.
Yep.
And here's the motive. Because I need something from you. But see, when you tell God you're sorry, you get what you need the most. His response. And his response is, I forgive you. And then that opens up everything else in the Christian life for the Christian, because that's how we become a Christian. In 2 Chronicles chapter 6, I mean, we're going to see this, I would describe it as lived out. You know, because there's a lot of examples in the Word of God of people that did it right, the people that didn't. And I think hopefully, you know, maybe we've all been examples of at least one, and hopefully both. But in 2 Chronicles chapter 6 and verse 36, and we're going to explain the context of the reading in a couple of minutes, but just listen along. Verse 36, 2 Chronicles chapter 6 says, if they sin against thee, there is no man that sinneth not, and thou be angry with them, and deliver them over to their before their enemies, and carry them away captives unto a land off or near, yet if they bethink, and we're going to talk about that word in a second, themselves in a land whither they be carried away captive, and turn and pray unto thee in the land of their captivity, saying, we have sinned and done amiss, and we have dealt wickedly. If they return to thee with all their heart and with all their soul in the land of their captivity, whether they've been carried away from captives, and pray toward their land, which you gave unto their fathers, and toward the city which thou hast chosen, and toward the house of them that built for thy name, then hear thou from the heavens, even from your dwelling place, their prayer and their supplications, and maintain their cause, and forgive thy people which have sinned against thee. Now, everybody repeat that with me.
Yeah.
Okay. let me explain to you what's going on. And this is, I always needed this when I was listening to teaching, still do today. Mm-hmm. The book of 2 Chronicles parallels 1 and 2 Kings, but virtually ignores the Northern Kingdom. That's history of Israel, stuff like that. And you'll see that in the Old Testament if you start reading it, or keep reading it, because of its false worship and refusal to acknowledge the Temple of Jerusalem. Chronicles focuses on those kings who patterned their lives after King David. The temple and temple worship, central throughout the book, suit a nation whose worship of God is central to its very survival. In the first chapter, we see the inauguration of Solomon as king. In other words, many of you heard the phrase or the person of King Solomon. In the second through the seventh chapter, we see a completion of the temple. And in chapter 6, where we just read, we see in the first 11 verses, we would describe as a Sermon of Solomon. This is followed by what I just read was part of a prayer by Solomon. And in that prayer, we see four examples of Solomon rehearsing various descriptions concerning the sin of Israel and their opportunity to experience forgiveness based on their desire to repent.
In this prayer, we see the responsibility of the sinner and the offer of the Lord when the sinner carries out his responsibility. In other words, this prayer, four different, on five different occasions, four different examples, Solomon is praying to God. And he's using examples and descriptions of various sins should the children of Israel commit these sins. And when he said that, it's kind of like the paraphrase. It's like, God, if they do this, and he describes something like this, and then he says, and after they do this, if they do this, and they cry out to you and ask you to forgive them, forgive them. And then he goes on and says, and if they do this, you know, and they cry out to you, forgive them. So it obviously is setting the stage for a biblical example of how we respond to what God offers. And what is God again? What does he offer? Forgiveness, right? Okay, so let's break this down quickly, and then we're going to have our share time. Verse 36, let me read it to you again. It says, if they sin against you, and then it says this, the Bible says this, for there is no man that sins not. Okay? Obviously, so nobody in the room, any other room, in any place on the planet, there's no man that sins not. And thou be angry with them, and deliver them over before their enemies, and they carry them away captives into a land far off or near. And I would call this a sure reality and a possible result. What's the reality? If they sin against you, he said to Solomon, if they sin against you, not as if they're not capable, but he knew the reality was that they're going to do it, because he followed that up by, and there ain't nobody that doesn't do that. See, you're not going to get to the place. You know, the goal is not sinless perfection. Because if the goal is sinless perfection, none of us are going to get there. We're going to drive ourselves crazy trying to get there. The goal is improvement. The goal is progress. The goal is not like, man, I'm just going to sin a little less today, and then a little less tomorrow, and I got a little sin over here, a little sin over there. No, that's not it.
No.
I mean, obviously, I'd like to go through a day without messing up the day,
amen,
without rebelling against, amen, God. And practically speaking, by the way, man, we can do that.
Amen.
We can do that. Because if we're not careful, we'll misunderstand what I just said about perfection. Mm. Because there ought to be some areas in your life and my life that I can't. Listen, I can perfect them.
Yeah.
I can. You say, man, you're raising the bar too high. No, I'm not, man. I ain't had any alcohol for almost 30 years.
Amen to that.
And I take the credit for that, but I did, and you did too, whether it's 30 days or 30 years. You did too. You participated in that.
That's right.
You responded to the opportunity and the availability of the power of God in your life.
Commitment.
And he helps you do that. He helps you do that. We're talking about that on Sunday mornings, about commitment.
Amen.
But the reality is, if they sin against you, he said, to some it may be a reminder, to others it may be an announcement. Either way, the fact still remains. There's nobody that doesn't sin. Nobody. It's sad that many of us have to learn about sin the way, by way of our participation, and have known less about sin by way of God's information. Suffice it to say that all of us have sinned and do sin, but none of us have to, listen, continue participating in habitual sin. There's a remedy. There's a remedy for that. It's ready. The same verse, and I've already quoted it twice, not to be redundant. In Romans chapter 6 and verse 14, it shall not have dominion over you. It's a verse, one of my favorite verses in the Bible that God showed me in the early part of my Christian life, before I was even clean. And that was the verse right there, sitting on that wall. I know it sounds selfish, but that's my verse, and that's why it's there. You know, you want a verse, get your own wall. God showed me that. God showed me that in a hardback Bible in an empty church. And you know, and here's what God showed me, just dumb as dirt, man, spiritually speaking, I was. And still, I'm half as dumb as I was. But the bottom line, he showed me that person, and what did God speak in my heart about? Rick, you are free. You are free. Stop thinking that you're going to get free one day. You are free, so now you need to learn how to live that way.
Amen to that.
Now, I mean, you are. If sin won't have dominion over you, and the Son shall make you free, you shall be free indeed. You shall know the truth. In the same chapter of the book of John, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. What's the problem? It ain't God.
No.
And fellas, I'm not trying to frustrate anybody in the room, but I do know this. It's progress. It's progress. It's getting stronger in an area where I was weak. And it is for you, and it is for me. Now listen, I got weak areas in my life. I got weak areas in my life. I say, what are they? I say, mind your own business. If I'm real weak, you won't have to ask, okay? Okay, but the bottom line is, you know, the reality is the fact that, listen, here it is. Let's not get to this spiritual elitism
where we act like we're not vulnerable to sin.
Right.
Solomon, the first part of his prayer, at least in this part of the prayer, was, if they sin against you, well, there's nobody that sins not. He got right to the point. He's looking back at the children of Israel going, I know they are. I know they are. And fellas, let's not set the bar too high for anybody else. And I'm not saying we ought not set it high, okay? Because Jesus is worth going after. Paul says that he strives toward the mark. You know, in other words, he's headed somewhere of the high calling, of the prize of high calling of Christ Jesus. He is headed toward that way. So he's not staying like he was. He's moving forward. He's moving forward. And so all of sin falls short of the glory of God. It may seem redundant for many Christians to be reminded of this, but all of us need to be reminded of what is at the root of the problem before we're ever going to address the solution. And I don't have a dog in this fight. I don't go around debating people. I don't call up people and say, let's go debate, you know, this and that, stuff like that on, you know, this kind of rehab, this kind of solution. But I can tell you that according to the Word of God, the problem is sin. That's the problem. And there's a remedy. There's a Redeemer. There's a person, the God-man, Jesus Christ, that came to break the chains of sin, death and the grave. And he conquered it. You don't think resurrection is conquer? Yeah. I don't know what it is, man. He died for sin and then beat death.
Amen.
So you and I can live according to the Word of God. So the reality, and then second, the possibility. Listen to what he said. If they sin against you, and this is interesting, and I'm almost certain everybody here can relate to this. Now, this is an Old Testament passage, but listen. Well, check out on me. If they sin against you, for there's no man that sins not, he said this, and thou be angry with them and deliver them over to their enemies, and they carry them away captives into a far off, into a land far off and, or near. That sounds like a Bible way of describing addiction. Listen to what he says. In this text, Solomon's speaking about God's children, the nation of Israel. He's not talking about Gentiles. Now, we can apply this, unless you're Jewish around here, and God bless you if you are. But I'm a Gentile. I'm a New Testament Christian. And I am under the dispensation of grace. He's talking to God's people. And so he says this, speaking about God's children, the nation of Israel, but just because I'm not a Jew doesn't mean I can't, practically speaking, experience the same thing and not think that this can't happen to me. Obviously, listen, we're not speaking concerning the possibility of being captured by enemies and being carried off to a far land. However, this text does have a clear spiritual application regarding habitual sin. What's the application? It speaks of the provoking the anger of the Lord. He said, and you be angry with them. Did you know? We don't like to talk about it, and we certainly don't like to think of it. But God gets angry. He does. And you and I can provoke that anger. As a parent, if you're a parent, by the way, you don't even have to be a parent. But people can make you mad. They provoke. In fact, the Bible talks about fathers, provoke not your children to wrath.
Yeah.
You know, in other words, don't pick at them. Don't tempt them. Don't taunt them to be mad at your just hoarding over them or something. I mean, we can apply that a lot of different ways. But the Bible speaks of the anger of the Lord. Psalm 6, verse 1. Yes. O Lord, rebuke me not in your anger, neither chasten me in your hot displeasure. Psalm 27, verse 9. Hide not thy face far from me. Put not your servant away in anger. Psalm 30, verse 5. For his anger endures but for a moment. See, we're going to get to the good part. In his favor, and that means delight or goodwill, is life. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning. So he speaks of the provoking the anger of the Lord. He also speaks of the possible response from the Lord when he says this, and deliver them before their enemies. If you know anything about the Old Testament, this happened a lot. In other words, God's people lost battles. And God's people were given over by the sovereignty and the providence of God to the enemy. It happened. And by the way, it happened because of their own rebellion. It didn't happen because God was going, well, I'm just going to choke you back over here so you can find out what it's like to be a slave. No, he didn't do it that way. He did it out of their own rebellion. In other words, they didn't intentionally invite him to do that. But by the way, we can do the same thing.
Listen to Judges chapter 2, verse 14. The anger of the Lord was hot against Israel. Who's Israel? God's what? God's people. And this is what happened. And he delivered them into the hands of the spoilers that spoiled them. And they're not talking about somebody that pampered them. The enemies. And sold them into the hands of their enemies round about. God did that. Judges chapter 1, 6 and verse 1. The children of Israel did evil in the sight of the Lord. And the Lord delivered them into the hand of Midian 7 years. And that was a short time for some of them, some of their experiences. Yeah. How can we apply that? Listen, if I don't want to, and we're not boxing God in, and we're not, and this is not necessarily, don't mistake this for arrogance, but if I don't want to do it God's way, God will let me do it another way. He will. And he'll let me. See, I can put it like this, in a practical way. I'm not a drug addict. I'm not, man. I'm not. You know, when Paul talks about it, in his writings, where he says and lists all these past descriptions of a sinful man, and by the way, I'm a sinner, but and he says, and such were some of you, and so I'm not buying into, I'm not disrespecting anybody that believes it. I'm not buying into once an addict, always an addict. I'm not a drug addict. I was one. I'm not an alcoholic. I was one. But I can tell you this: I could be one again. You can always change, but I could be one again, and God would listen. If I wanted to, and God forbid, and I'm not making light of this whatsoever, but if I wanted to go back to that, I have a free will. And I could go back to that. And if I go back to that, God can, by description, turn me back over to that enemy. Be sober, be vigilant, Simon Peter said, for your adversary, your enemy, the devil as a roaring lion, roameth about, seeking whom he may devour.
Yeah.
Now, who do you think he was writing that to? He wasn't writing it to lost people. So if you let him, he's been doing it a lot longer than we've been trying to stay away from it, man. He's a trained professional. But greater is he that is in you. It's called God power. No disrespect. But here, greater is he that is in you than he's in the world. But lest we think, listen, take heed. As we think too highly of ourselves, that this couldn't happen. And it's not happening because God wants it to happen. It is just a manifestation of rebellion. It's not a symptom. It is a description of the rebellious man. He just turns himself over. He surrenders to the enemy. It's his own free will. It's not a capture. You know, I've heard that before, no disrespect to anybody that said it, but you know, people say, well, I lost this and I lost that. And again, you might want to rethink that. It's not a loss, it's a trade.
That's right.
It's a trade, man. Right. It ain't a loss. Nobody took anything from me. I know he cometh not there but to steal, kill, and destroy, but I got to participate in that.
Yeah.
It's a trade. Very rarely did I get free dope.
Okay.
I'd have gotten in line, but I'm just saying. I know, it's a trade. You know? And I never really lost a job because of it, but you know, if somebody lost a job because of it, now it's a trade. Handed it one thing over for another thing. And that's what happens here. And it speaks to the possible response of God. But listen, it speaks to the possible experience of the rebellious. And they carried them away captives unto a land, listen, far off or near. It doesn't matter. Captive is a captive. You know, we got something, I mean, not exactly like this, but Guantanamo Bay. That's far off for more than likely the people that are there. But listen, prison up there in Washington County might not be any more pleasant than the one down there in Guantanamo Bay. Far off or near. Captive is captive.
That's right.
Yeah.
You know, the prodigal son went to the far country. What was he? Captive. Yeah. I went to the back alley. What was that?
Captive.
You know, and he got nothing to do with geography. And so we see that, listen, that's a sure reality. That's a reality. That's what happens according to the Word of God and a possible result. And quickly, a sure invitation. Here's the good part. You know, unfortunately, if this can happen and we just describe it, here's the good part. A sure invitation. First, a sure reality and a possible result. And then a sure invitation and a descriptive method. In other words, if we don't do this God's way, it ain't getting done.
That's right.
It ain't getting done. We can dream it up. We can kind of think, what is what I think about God? And we've all had those kind of opinionated views of God. And more than likely, most of us, when we had those opinionated views of God, when we got into the Word of God, we found out how wrong our opinions were. You know, I just figured God, like, if you don't mess with him, he'll leave you alone.
I really did, man. I was like, just don't mess with him, man. You know, it's like that big dude in the class. Don't mess with the dude. You know, if you got to carry his books, you know. But like, but God's not into that. Now, I would, let me put a disclaimer on that. Don't mess with God, okay? But I'm not talking about that because God's not just ready to pounce on people. That's not the God of the Bible. If he was, why would he draw us to himself? Why would he do that? He would, and by the way, he does, the Bible says he resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. And you can't get God to resist that. It resists you. But the bottom line is, God's not like that. The invitation of God says this. He said, yet if they, here's what Solomon said. If they, now this is a word we never use, more than likely, bethink. If you think that, if you use the word bethink, you're probably using it, you know, just in kind of butchering the English language, okay? But it means if they turn. So let's use it like that. If they turn back themselves in the land where they're carried captive and turn and pray unto thee in the land of their captivity. Now let's stop there for a second. He said if they turn. What does repentance mean? To turn. And so he said if they turn, and this is interesting to me. I mean, it's a blessing to me to see it like this. And I know we can apply it like this. If they return themselves in the land where they were carried away captive. In other words, it doesn't speak of anything about cleaning up your act and then coming to God. He said, come to me where you are.
Right.
It said, in the land of your captivity. So which means, those times at 3 in the morning, where I was down in Dirtville, it was okay for me to call on God. God, listen, God forbid if we have a God that waits to us to get out of Dirtville before we can call him. To, you know, do Christianity 101, 102, 103, and get a C+ at least in them with a 3.0 or something like that. Now, Rick, you're cleaned up, you straightened up a little bit, you know, you got perfect attendance for 3 months, now you can call me. No, God said, that, listen, if they turn back themselves in a land, whether they're carried, and turn and pray unto thee in the land of their captivity. Fellas, listen, where the captivity is where it starts. That's where it starts, man. And we can sit here and talk all night if you wanted to. I'm saying we're not going to. You can, but I ain't gonna be here. But we can talk all night of crying out to God in our captivity. Yeah. And God said, that's all right. That's all right. God forbid that anybody else goes back there. But you remember October, whatever it is tonight, that God said, it's okay to cry out to him anytime.
Amen.
Yes. Praise God. Yeah.
Anytime. But it's what we cry that makes the difference. It's not that we cry.
Yeah,
and what we cry is what he said. And the amazing description of that, listen, is the admission. Listen to what, here's the application. The admission of where we are and what we've done. Now, God doesn't have to go like, you know, Rick, you said you were in Weewall, but you were in Caravelle. You know what I mean? That's not what we're talking about. Where we are spiritually. Listen to what he said. If they turn themselves in the land where they're carried away captive, and turn and pray to be in the land of their captivity, saying, we have sinned and done amiss. That word amiss means to do wrong or perversely. And we have dealt wickedly. So the admission is how it is. And then the admission is what we've done. Now, fellas, if you think that God is dependent, our forgiveness is dependent upon naming everything that we've done wrong, we'd still be there.
Yeah.
That's not what he's talking about. He's not talking about, Rick, give me a detailed list of everything that you've done wrong. But what I do want to hear from you, Rick, is that you admit that you've sinned against me.
Amen.
And fellas, and I've said this before, and I know it has helped me, as painful sometimes as it is, but there is something spiritually healing about naming what we've done to God.
Yeah.
Because he is the safest place to take it. You start doing that around certain people, certain areas, and I'm not saying that this is not a safe place to do that, and we don't discourage or encourage people to do that, but I'm going to tell you what, when I can tell God, this is what I've done, and I feel bad about what I've done, I am grieved over what I've done, and I ain't even been, hey, surprise, surprise, and I ain't even been caught. And I'm just sick of sinning against you, God.
Yeah.
I'm sick of it.
Yeah.
I'm sick of what it does to you. I'm sick of what it's doing to me. And listen, there ain't no good day as a follower of Jesus Christ when you're living in sin.
No, not at all.
There ain't, man.
Right.
When are we going to get that? When are we going to get that?
Yeah.
And the relief comes when we just straight up gut level honest with God.
Amen. True.
And you know what? You know, and not just to park there, but while we're at it, we ought to rehearse with God how it happened. God, this is what I was doing. This is what I was thinking. And God, I can look back, and a little bit I know about the Word of God, you told me there was a way of escape. And God, now that I think about it, I can see it. And I didn't take it.
Yeah.
And I took another route. In fact, I didn't run from the sin. God, I ran straight to it. Maybe it took me a little while. Then I tried to hold my own and everything like that. But God, this is the way it happened. And when we do that, listen, the next time we're tempted, we can see that.
Yeah.
What are we doing? We're getting experience from our failure. We don't need more of that, but failure can be a good teacher.
Yeah, it can.
Oh, yeah. That's
if you'll be honest about how it happened.
Yep.
And so as we do, listen, the admission of where we are and what we have done, and then quickly, the desire to be where we should be and doing what we should do, we should be doing. This is what he said. If they return to you with all their heart and with all their soul in the land of their captivity, where they've been carried away captives, and pray toward their land, which you gave unto their fathers, and toward the city that you have chosen, and toward the house which I have built for my name. What did he say? He said, listen, you get to where you should be. Most of the time we sin, I'm not saying like geographically, but it would include this, where we ought not be. We're not only doing what we should be doing, but you ain't going to go in the middle of the intersection of Harrison and 6th Street and play the fool. You are, wait for us all to watch. We might be able to help you, I don't know. But I mean, the bottom line is, we don't normally do that. We go typically to a place.
Yeah.
Back to the prodigal. What did he do? He went to a place. What did David do? He was in a place. What did Saul do? He was in a place. We go on and on and on. What did Simon Peter do? He was in a warming his hands by the fire. He was in a place.
Yep.
Not necessarily that he should not be, but he didn't have to be. He's around the enemies of Christ. Starts warming up to him. Next thing you know, one thing leads to another. And so when we're where we're supposed to be and we're doing what we're supposed to be doing,
yeah.
And that is, fellas, if there's a simple practical key to the Christian life, overcome
that's it.
The weight and the burden of the sin that so easily besets you, there it is.
Amen.
Get involved in the Christian life.
Yes.
Not just be a doer for the sake of staying busy. I talked to somebody recently, and they said, and they were working and working and working and working and working 50, 60 hours a week. I said, why do you work so much? Because I like to stay busy. And this person has addictive behavior, so to speak. And I'm not being disrespectful or anything like that. I mean, that's where they were quite some time ago. And I'm related to that person. They're not my immediate family, but in my distant family. I said, well, what is busyness going to do? And it just keeps me busy, so I don't do what I'm not supposed to do. I said, okay. I said, well, what is going to happen when you reach the point of life where you can't do that?
Yeah.
What are you going to do? See, I can do what God wants me to do and be doing kind of like nothing.
Yeah.
I mean, reading is something.
Yeah.
But if that means I need to be running all over town and running errands and doing stuff like that, I ain't nothing wrong with running errands. But there is place in the Bible that says, be still.
Yeah.
And know that I'm God.
That's a lot.
Amen.
The word rest is all over the Word of God.
Yep.
Now, don't go quitting your job tomorrow. Right? Don't be playing that game with me and say, Rick, man, I just heard some of the best preaching I've ever heard in my life. Okay, no, don't do that. But I'm saying, rest in the Lord. No? They that wait upon the Lord. We talked about that in Sunday school not too long ago. You know? And so, if we're doing what we're supposed to be doing, or where we're supposed to be, then God will take care of the rest. It's sad, and it sometimes takes away, listen, takes being away from God to miss the nearness of God.
That's right.
It does not have to get that way, but many of us would admit that it's gotten that way before. In spite of that, we also know that it does not have to get that way again. There are many examples in God's Word that we can learn from where people just like us get careless and rebellious and wander away from God. God calls, and God draws, and it's our responsibility to respond to His calling. There are many promises in God's Word regarding His response. We have already mentioned a few, but repentance is God's way, or it is not repentance at all. We're just throwing up, I'm sorry, and stuff like that. You know, most of the time, if not all the time, the dust never settles just because of that. But it can be with the right heart. I'm not talking about we just got to have this totally figured out, but with the right heart, based on our response to what we know about the Word of God, when we repent, when we ask God to forgive us, God gets involved.
Yeah.
What's the Bible say in the book of James in chapter 4, verse 8? Draw nigh to God, He'll draw nigh to you. That's what God said He'll do. When I do the best I can with what I have, just to get closer to God. God said, when you do that, you step, I step. By the way, He's already there, isn't He? It's not like God runs away from us and taunts us and goes, you never catch me. No, He says, you draw near to me and I'll draw near to you. One of the best verses in the Bible that many, if not everybody in here has heard about it. 2 Chronicles 7:14, If my people, which are called by my name, shall do what? Humble themselves and pray, seek my face, and turn from their wicked ways, then. And I would say, not adding to the Word of God to be irreverent, but only then will I hear from heaven, I'll forgive their sin, and I'll heal their land. And fellas, if you're here tonight and you haven't done that, well, I would say, and I'm not here to put you on the spot, trust me, that ain't going to happen. But if you haven't done that, you ought to. I say that as a friend, not as somebody trying to make you feel uncomfortable. That's where it all starts. If your struggle is without God, then your struggle, in all due respect, is on your own. And I can tell you this in closing, we're going to have our prayer time. Addiction is bigger than everybody in this room.
True.
It's a monster. If it were not so, why did I chase something that had everything, all the power to get me up, to put me down, to take me across town, to take me back over this town, make me lose my car, make me lose whatever else I had, make me trade this, make me trade that, give up my money, all the money I ever had in my pocket, I'm throwing it out and slinging it, throwing dope and everything like that. And it was something that did not weigh, in most cases, a gram. That's pretty powerful.
Yeah, well, so true.
And if I was to say that to somebody in this room, I'll tell you what, mess with me, and I'll throw a rock this big at you and destroy your life.
Yeah, it's so true, though. It's so true, man.
Yeah. Oh, but it happens.
Right. Every day.
Yep. But it doesn't have to.
No.
It doesn't have to. If you turn, keep on.
Amen.
That's turn right. From your sin once for salvation. If you mess it up, you goof it up, you sin against God, repent, not for your relationship with God, but that fellowship that you can enjoy with God, and just tell God you're sorry. What does God do? If I confess my sins, He's faithful and just to forgive me my sins. Cleanse me from all my mercies. And if you're right with the Lord, stay close. Stay close. You know? Your next, I don't use words like breakthrough and stuff like that, but who knows what God will do if we'll stay on this journey.
Amen.
He does. I don't.
So true.
I don't. But He does. And it ain't going to be bad. You know, you might experience bad frustration, even tragedy. Who knows? But God's bigger than all that. And He loves you unconditionally.